This is a dynamic disease. In other words, it's progression, and dynamics are in part and parcel a story in which one symptom creates a problem which produces a symptom, and things go on in that fashion. An addict drinks and he feels guilty about what he does when he's drinking, and then he drinks to relieve the guilt that was caused by his drinking. It's a dynamic process, and that's what we'll show you tonight, will be the movie version. And instead of my talking about a movie, I'm going to show you at least several film clips to give you a sample of a low-bottom alcoholic, somebody who has really hit bottom, an ordinary drug addiction. The first one will be a cocaine addiction, and we'll let that go on for about 10 minutes. And then we'll stop it, of course, and we'll try to talk about the dynamic process called addiction. So hit my lights.
Los Angeles is a great place.
We don't have any friends in Los Angeles.
We don't have any friends here. We have each other. No, we'll still have each other, you and me. Linda, this is my big chance.
What about my job?
You're not going to work in L.A. For a change, I'll be supporting you. You can dance.
No, we should. Maybe we're going too fast. We should just take this a step at a time.
The hell with that. You don't step through life. Teacher, may I? It goes too quick for that. You got to leap through life.
What about our apartment, all our stuff?
Just dump. This junk, you think I'm going to take this crap to L.A.? We'll get new furniture that's right for L.A. You think a successful man in L.A. asks his wife to park her behind on junk like this? Forget about it!
Come and get it, crazy!
We're out of here!
Yeah.
Come on, are you with me? Let me see you leave. Come and get it.
Goodness, my puppy. I was thinking what great come. Lenny! Lenny! Lenny!
He's going to be all right. Your husband's had a phase two reaction to cocaine. How long has he been using the drug?
Cocaine?
Do you know how much he took?
My husband doesn't use drugs. He doesn't even drink anything stronger than wine. He'd been at a party. Somebody must have slipped him something. Tell them anything.
You didn't use any of that stuff, did you?
No.
You threw it out?
Of course I did.
See, I couldn't find Michael. I had to buy him off the street. That's what happened. And I'm supposed to be smart.
What about the hospital bill?
Outright thieves. I put on the American Express.
Hey, Michael.
Got any? You got any?
Yeah.
Where'd you get it?
From Michael.
Good. Great. Great.
He wanted to me for it.
Son of a bitch! I'll kill him, man.
Don't look at me like that, Lenny. I'd never do anything like that.
So how'd you pay for it?
I hocked my ring.
What, they don't have any lawyers left in New York?
Yes, indeed. I happen to be one myself.
Mr. Zimmer, you're asking Lenny about things that should properly be a part of the fine-tuning. Why? We know you're a smart guy.
We're talking about staking a lot of money and our reputations on your husband's plan. Now, everybody knows Lenny's a smart guy, too, but he's had some problems.
Mike. Sorry, Lenny, Linda. Mike's timing is a little off.
You want to blame me for an IRS upheaval that decimated the tax shelter business across the country? Fine. Hey,
I can take this plan to GenStar.
Lenny, we love the idea in its broad strokes, but naturally we did a quick background check and there were some rumors. Now, when we all get around the big table and somebody waltzes in and starts telling stories about you, we'd like to be able to tell him he's full of shit.
Oh, excuse me, Faraday. Let's not go back to your Arab friends who wipe their asses with their bare hands and have them get the wrong idea. You sit there on your fat MBA and try to figure out how to steal my idea because just maybe I won't fit into your club of Arab fuckers and this isn't my goddamn table. This is his first night, you know, he'll be fired for this.
Lenny, what are you talking about? The table's fine. We're just here to try to do some business.
You've been spending half the night creaming over my wife while this schmuck humiliates me. I don't need you assholes. I can get plenty of action on this idea. Check. Hey, let me out of this dump.
Lenny isn't feeling well.
You think I'm a junkie? I'll act like a junkie for him.
Lenny, we may want to come back here. Why don't you go home? We'll take a cab.
No, I'll drive you. I'm your servant. I'm supposed to be nice to people like you.
This idea is good. Don't hold this against
me. God damn it, Lenny. Don't rumble! My idea's going to be on the cover of Fortune. Linda? Linda?
Who's the guy? Svengali. Svengali. From day one, this airy fairy doctor had this Svengali control over her. Kept me away. Got her to move in with him. But you know what? She still loves me. She calls me up on the phone, asks me how I am. Says to me, Lenny, in that way she used to. I beg her to come back, but she says she can't. It's a doctor. He's got this hold on her, like Svengali. But Lenny Brown does not give up. One good maneuver and Lenny Brown is back in business. Clean up. Buy a house on the hill for cash, some decent wheels, and get my girl back. It'll be like it all happened to somebody else. I don't know. A couple of years ago, I never even thought about tables at Morton's. And then I lose my prospects, my girl, my wife. And God knows what all, because I went crazy because I didn't get the right table. Now, what the hell does it mean when you lose everything over nothing?
I don't know, Lenny.
I gotta get some capital together. It takes money to make money. Which is why I'm gonna have to ask you to leave now, Ned. I got a customer coming.
Is there anything I can do for you?
Can you bring Linda back? Just kidding. Oh, Jesus. It's so nice to see a face from the old days, Ned. I won't lie to you, it's been kind of hard to concentrate because I kind of miss having her around. I keep turning to her, you know, to say things. And she's not there.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. I knew from the first time I saw her that if I could ever have her, I could never keep her. I always knew that I would lose her. And I was right, wasn't I?
Goodbye, Len.
Hey, Ned. Why the long face? Now that you're writing for the Times, we'll run into each other. L.A. is a small town. You'll stick with me. Please.
Till I fall off. Wintergreen gum?
I'm sorry, I don't think we carry that.
Hey! Hey! Come out here, this lady's having a fit! Hey! Oh, she's spasming all over the place! Come on! I think she might follow her tongue. Look at that!
Are you too busy to take some money
just a minute.
Hey, wait a minute, man. She's foaming here.
I need an ambulance. A woman is having an epileptic seizure.
So.
Are you sure you're okay?
Down a little bit and then bang, you knock off another pharmacy.
Bullshit, man.
I didn't kind of expect me to drop
by. I didn't mean to be a drugstore in years.
Bullshit.
Look, man.
I got a warrant. I got it pasted on the end of one of these slugs. Now, you give me any more shit, I'm gonna give you a good close look at one of them.
Oh, heavy, man. You guys been reading too much Mickey Spillane or something?
Yeah, you don't seem to understand, Bobby.
Hey, come on, knock those clubs. Those are my Ben Hogan's, man. Why you gotta mess with the clubs?
What are you hitting these days?
I got my handicap down here around 8.
8? Bullshit. Where do you play?
Mayfield. I hit a 75 last time I was out there.
I don't play those public courses, greaseball. Mayfield is for pussies, and that's why you have an 8 handicap.
Well, how am I supposed to play? My clubs are all broke. Come on, man. Have a heart.
Break 2 more and then leave the clubs alone. All right?
Thanks, man.
And Diane. You haven't gone and hid the drugs in some stupid place like the Frosted Flakes again, have you?
I don't know what the hell you're talking about.
Let's go here now. Check on the bottom.
Jesus. How old is she? Is she over 18?
22. You're 22 years old, right?
22.
22.
Lucky for you. Okay, kiddies. Here's how it's coming down. You can just tell us where the drugs are and save yourself a whole lot of trouble.
or you can sit there with your mouth shut. We're gonna tear this place apart, board by board. Now, how's it gonna be?
Baby, we are on our way. God, it's great out there. I mean, everybody is thirsty.
Come to me. Harry. I'm so glad.
Actually.
For Christ's sake.
I don't know what I'm gonna have to do to get it.
Look, baby. We'll be back in business in no time. We'll start moving again. We'll start saving. It'll be perfect, just like it was. I promise, Marion.
What I wanted to give you just a sample of was the variety of addicts, first of all. Mainstream people with fancy jobs, as well as kids who are robbing drugstores, plus plain old everyday garden variety alcoholics who went to work today. There are heroin users. Nasty drug, nasty world. But it's all addiction. And the dynamics, regardless of the drug and regardless of the kinds of people who use it, the process of addiction is pretty much the same. I remember running a group in which we had eight different kinds of people in the group. There was actually a physician. There was a street punk. There was a woman who was often referred to outside as a cocaine whore. There was an officer of the law. So it was quite a variety. And I swore if you closed your eyes and somebody was speaking, you couldn't tell who was telling the story. Because all the stories were similar. You know, the progression and the dynamics of addiction are similar despite the variety of people who have it, etc. Obviously, there are going to be differences between people who have to break the law to get the drug. I've been asked, is there a difference between an alcoholic and a heroin addict? The answer is yes. The heroin addict has to break the law to get the drug. The alcoholic doesn't have to break the law to get the drug. So one breaks it before he uses, the other breaks it after he's drunk. But if you close your eyes to the differences in drug types, the progression and the dynamics are pretty much the same. And so what I'm going to do is give you a kind of the story version. When I first heard this disease called a killer, my initial reaction to that was, oh God, do we have to overstate everything in order to catch people's attention? Why don't we just tell them the simple truth? And avoid all these exaggerated notions. And yet the longer I hung around alcoholism, drug addiction, they're the same thing, okay? Alcoholism is a drug addiction. It's addiction to alcohol, all right? And its progression is no different than the heroin addict who injects or the cocaine addict who snorts. I thought, you know, we don't have to overstate this. The more I hung around it, though, the more you recognize that this thing is programmed to kill you. It wants to take your life. And it does that in three ways. One is it makes you sick. Two is that while it's making you sick, it makes you believe that you're not sick. And then three is after you come to the realization that you have an addiction and have to do something about it, before you get better, it feels worse. So it kills people. Makes you sick, tells you you're not. Before you get better, you feel worse. And so people don't survive early recovery. They don't stay abstinent long enough until they begin to realize some of the benefits. So here's a disease that makes you sick. Well, you say, all diseases make you sick. Why should this be any different? And the reason is because of the very complex way in which it makes you sick. Diabetes, you know, affects your pancreas. Addiction affects your brain, your mind, your emotions, and your spirit. It's kind of a whole human being process, okay? It poisons your brain. It equips your mind with a terrific denial system so that you don't believe you have the disease. It distorts emotions and emotional life. Addicts don't experience feelings normally. They usually experience them in extremes, all right? Either they stuff their feelings or they blow or explode with their feelings. And so when they get sober, they're not sure what real anger is because they haven't experienced just plain old anger, all right? And it makes you sick in a, it makes you feel hopeless. So in a sense, it does make you spiritually sick. Your mind and its thinking revolves around drug use. Your feelings are processed through a chemically altered brain. You live a life that's elated, sedated, and agitated. I had a young girl in recovering when she was 19 in AA, and she used to describe it as that it made me up, down, and ya-ya. And that I would do that for days on end, weeks on weeks, months on months, years on years. Up, down, ya-ya. Up, down, ya-ya. In different ways, that's what drugs do. They may be in a different order, but that's what they do. And you feel dispirited, disheartened, discouraged. Any of you tried to stop smoking and not succeeded at it? How do you feel after the end of that, having relapsed back into smoking several times? After a while, what you say is, I can't win. I can't beat it. The addiction's more powerful than me. The cravings are more powerful than my mind is able to contend with them. I know it's irrational to continue smoking, but I keep doing it. And after a while, you feel kind of hopeless, just hopeless. So it makes you sick. While it's making you sick, of course, it tells you that you're not sick. And that's the denial system. In other words, the only way to get sick with an addiction is to come to believe that you don't have it. That your mind has to trick you into thinking that other people might think you have a problem with alcohol or heroin or cocaine or marijuana, but you don't think you have a problem. Or you think it's the solution, not the problem. Don't you understand that marijuana is my solution? It's not my problem. It's what makes me feel mellow, less on edge, etc., etc., etc. So the real target, actually, the better definition, if you want a quick definition for denial, it's a process of self-deception. Your denial system is not meant to fool me, if I'm your counselor, if I'm the assessment individual. Your denial system is intended to fool you. Got to keep you in the dark about this, all right? Why? Because denial is a protection against pain as you see it. You think that, my God, if I see the truth, I'm going to be in a ton of pain. Because one of the things you're going to ask me to do is to stop using the drug, and I don't think I can. Or I don't think I want to. Or both, I don't think I can, and I don't think I want to. And if I have to abstain, it scares the Jesus out of me. So your denial system is intended to fool you. It's not that an addict knows the truth and is lying. He doesn't know the truth as you know it. He has created a version of that truth which is intended to protect him, to keep him out of pain. So don't think that what we've got in front of us here is a inveterate liar. He's not an inveterate liar. It's a difficult-to-diagnose disease. The brain is drugged. You're trying to diagnose addiction. You're trying to do that with a brain that's drugged, a mind that's in denial, about a disease which is hard to diagnose in the first place. There are sometimes that professionals have difficulty figuring out whether this is loss of control? Is it intentional intoxication? Or is it accidental intoxication? Is this real tolerance or just heavy drinking? They're not the same. They're not the same. So sometimes it's difficult for even the pros to figure out this disease. And hell, if we can't figure it out, you know that damn well that with a denial system in place, you're going to have even more trouble figuring out. A culture, you live in a culture which blurs the difference between normal and abnormal drinking. We make all kinds of mistakes thinking that a single incident of drunkenness is suggestive of alcoholism. It's not. It's not. It's a single night of drunkenness. So we have a hard time figuring out exactly what is heavy drinking. At what point do you cross the line? How much do you have to drink in order for it to be called heavy drinking? And again, that's a tough one to figure out. Fear and pride blocks the diagnosis. I mean, if you diagnose it, you're saying, I'm going to have to stop drinking. And that's the scary part. And the pride part is, who wants to volunteer for being an alcoholic or drug addict? Well, one of the children of darkness, drinking the devil's brew, a dipsomaniac, a megalomaniac. Anybody offer to confess to that? Well, of course you don't want to, all right? And guess what? If you don't want to be an alcoholic, at least in your own mind, you won't be one. And if you have it, you'll just get sicker. And then you'll play all kinds of word games with this disease. You know, you will believe that it wasn't your drinking that caused the accident, it was the brakes on the Ford. Ford must make some shitty brakes, because I've had a lot of patients tell me it was the brakes on the Ford. And then, unfortunately, before it gets better, it feels worse. You wake up you finally get to the point where you say, my God, I lose control when I drink. I'm going to have to stop. And you stop, and you say, oh, my God. This is worse. This feels worse. Because you're faced with the reality of your life and you're faced with a brain that is reeling from intoxication and toxicity poison for years. You're not ready to handle what you have to handle. And some people simply don't stay sober long enough to begin to feel better. It feels worse at first. It's an early recovery issue. Early recovery is difficult. If anybody tells you, no, just stop drinking and you'll live happily ever after, it's not true. You'll stop drinking and for the first year you'll be miserable. Or for the first period of time, you'll be miserable. Early recovery is difficult. It's painful. And some people just don't stay sober through it. Because of it. It's designed to do you in. It's designed to kill you. It'll make you sick till you're not, before you get better. Now let's see if you can survive this experience. It's called early recovery. So, self-diagnosis is key. Now, I know I have a friend who says to me all the time, Dick, only doctors can diagnose diseases. You can't tell a patient he's got to diagnose the disease. And I usually say to Jeff, I know that's generally true for most diseases, but addiction's different. The critical diagnosis in addiction is not the one the doctor makes, it's the one the patient makes. It's based on this axiom. No one has ever recovered from a disease he did not have. Right? Ever imagine someone saying, I think I'll fix my crabgrass problem. And they live downtown. They don't have a lawn. You say you don't have problems, and you know, you don't fix problems until you have problems. So self-diagnosis is key. I can tell you whether or not you have an addiction if you'll sit down with me for about an hour and a half and you'll answer my questions honestly. And even if you lie, I've gotten fairly good at figuring out when they're lying or not. I've been doing this for a long time. All right. So self-diagnosis is essential to recovery. But self-diagnosis is also especially difficult. Wow. You want to know how to stop addiction? You take a look partly at what keeps it going. All right? So there are five things that keep it going. And if you can start messing with and playing with those five factors, you may have some success in encouraging someone to move in the direction of treatment. Can you make someone sober? If you can, I've got to meet you because I'm going to hire you. I'm going to take you wherever I go, all right? No, you can't make somebody sober. You can encourage them in that direction. You can do a bunch of things that we'll discuss in Lecture 8, but you can't make them sober. So treating the disease requires knowing what keeps it going, and here are those factors. First of all, this addiction is a process of cellular brain level adaptation and growing tolerance, okay? What happens in an addiction is the use of the drug creates the conditions for needing to continue to use the drug. The metaphor that we use these days, and we'll explain this at greater length in other lectures, is that the drug hijacks the dopamine system. So you feed it dopamine through Jim Beam. And the brain says, look, we're getting plenty of dopamine from Jim Beam. We don't have to produce the dopamine. So it cuts down on the dopamine. Now, dopamine is the pleasure chemistry of the human brain. So now that you've reduced dopamine, what do you have to do to get dopamine? Jim Beam. And of course, every time you use Jim Beam, it reduces the dopamine. So you have to revert to Jim Beam. So that process is the process that these days we're talking about as the progression of an addiction. No one is studying the alcoholic personality. That was dismissed over 30 years ago. No one is studying family dynamics. They're studying family genetics, but not family dynamics. All right? This is a brain disease. And one of the things that keeps it going is that process by which the brain uses the drug, ending up in susceptible people now to use more of the drug. Doesn't happen to everybody, right? How many people do you know who drink but never have this process happen to them? How many of you know someone who's drank all their lives and they never had a problem with alcohol? Sure. It doesn't happen to everyone, but some susceptible people are the people to whom that kind of thing happens. Growing tolerance. And guess what? Tolerance is not the result of heavy drinking. It usually works the other way around. Heavy drinking is the result of tolerance. You don't become tolerant because you drink too much. You drink too much because you're tolerant. How many of you know someone who is tolerant from the very start, even in high school? They could hold more than everybody else. In fact, there are some people about whom we said they had a hollow leg. It's common. it's a common enough experience in America that we have an idiom by which to talk about it, that we recognize that there were some people who didn't develop tolerance. They were always tolerant. They were tolerant from the start. And when you talk to alcoholics, they'll be damned if they can tell you at what point they became tolerant. They say, it just sort of happened. I'm not sure when I crossed that line. I just know that at some point I woke up and realized, my God, I can hold a whole lot more than I could 20 years ago, because it's like aging. You don't recognize that you've aged from day to day. You recognize it when you look back at that photograph album that was taken 20 years ago and say, oh shit, I've gotten older. You have, but you didn't notice it. What can you do about that? Well, the second thing that keeps it going is a cycle of symptoms. I explained before. You drink, you drive your friends away, and then you drink because you're lonely. You drink and you get agitated and angry and resentful, and then you drink to calm down. You drink because you're depressed, you drink and get depressed, and then you drink because you're depressed. You drink and you feel guilty about what you've done, and you drink to relieve the guilt and the shame. So it's a dynamic. In addition to this brain that's adapting, it's a process in which symptom seems to trigger other symptoms of the same type, and it keeps getting worse. So what can you do about that? Well, the answer is the only solution for either of those, you can't do a thing about that as long as the drinking's going on, right? As long as you're drinking and you're susceptible, your brain is going to adapt to the drug, and in some cases, you're going to become tolerant. In some cases, you've already been tolerant. The only thing you can do about that is get the drug use to stop. Now, how do you do that? Well, any way that'll work, frankly. The only thing that will stop the cycle of symptoms, if you stop the first one, don't drink. If you don't pour alcohol through the hole in your face, that process won't start. So the only thing we can do about that is get the patient abstinent. That's part of the reason you send them to treatment, because if nothing else happens there, you get somebody abstinent at least, well, we used to have 30 days. Now you hardly have that anymore. It's a damn shame, I think. But we can keep them from drinking alcohol for those 30 days. Yeah, they try to sneak it. Of course they try to sneak it. Yeah, they hide it. Yeah, we know they hide it. And sometimes we win, and sometimes the cops win, and sometimes the robbers, you know. Sometimes the statues win, sometimes the birds win. Next thing keeps going is the denial system. You won't treat a disease if you don't think you have it. And that's what denial is intended to do, to help you believe you don't have it. You don't have it. Now, what can we do? There is something we can do about that, right? We can get the denial system, we can confront the denial system, and we can have it erode. Most of the time, denial erodes. It rarely, but occasionally, does collapse. I've had a couple of fairly dramatic cases in which I was working with an individual in which a single intervention, which was relatively simple, caused this particular patient, there were two of them, their denial system to just fall apart on the floor in front of them. Okay? I said, oh my God, I'm alcoholic, with one session. I've only seen it happen twice. Most of the time, it erodes, all right? It slowly, gradually erodes. It's a kind of an awakening. If you can get somebody abstinent and give him time to think about his history with the drug, he can begin to see that pattern of loss of control, begin to see that the growing tolerance for the drug. But you got to get them abstinent. As long as they're drinking, it's real tough to get that denial system to do anything but to continue. Next thing that keeps it going is that there are people and institutions and policies that will enable the disease. Now, enable doesn't mean cause the disease. You cannot cause alcoholism. You might be the nastiest person on the face of the earth, but no act on your part can make someone tolerant, can make someone lose control, can cause someone to persist in drinking even after drinking has caused them to lose their right leg. That's addiction that causes that. And you're not capable of causing an addiction. So if you're a parent thinking you've caused your son or your daughter an addiction, let go of that notion. You can't do it. Addiction is diagnosed by a pattern of loss of control, tolerance, and persistence despite problems. You can't cause any of that. So let go of the illusion that somehow you made this happen. You can't. You can't make it happen. But you can enable it to continue. You can enable it by denying it yourself, covering up for it, rescuing the patient from the consequences of his addiction. You know, you bail him out. As long as you bail him out, he doesn't have a problem. You know, you have a problem. Your wallet's emptying. But he didn't have a problem because he doesn't have to hit the wall. All right? And then, of course, by nagging and badgering and hassling. If you don't stop drinking, drugging, I'm going home to mother. Well, first of all, you better have mother to go home to, all right? And you better damn sight mean that. If you just bluff it, it's not going to work. It will help further enable the disease to continue. So you'll say, if you don't stop drinking, I'm going home to mother. You don't carry through with it. And he goes to a bar and he says to his friend, you'd drink too if I had a wife like mine. His friend says, I know, I do. And then one person enables the other person. So how do you stop that? Is just that. You stop that. You figure out what benefit you're getting, what motivates the enabling, and you find another way to show that benefit without enabling the addiction. People enable because they love. Well, you better find another way to love than to enable them. They enable because they hope. They hope it'll work. Well, you better find another way to feel hope without enabling. So, and you can do something about that. You can confront the, you can get enablers to stop enabling. And the last thing is hopelessness. One of the reasons that an addiction continues, and I think one of the best demonstrations of this is with nicotine, as a matter of fact, is a terrible sense of hopelessness one feels when he has tried repeatedly to stop and can't. You just feel, I can't do it. Addiction is more powerful than my will. I have will. I have willpower. People make the mistake of thinking, you know what's wrong with an addict? He doesn't have willpower. That's not what's wrong with him. What's wrong with him is the addiction stronger than the willpower. He's got plenty of willpower. It just doesn't work. In AA, they tell you addiction against willpower against an addiction is about as effective as an umbrella in a hurricane. It's not that the umbrella isn't a useful tool. It just doesn't work in a hurricane. Addiction is a hurricane. Addiction is a powerful force driven by lots of things, okay? And willpower unaided is not an effective tool. You need the will to get sober, but you better not count on willpower by itself. It's assisted willpower. It's supported willpower that may work. But willpower all by itself, I'm just going to fight this thing. Look what you're trying to fight. You're trying to fight a brain that's produced a craving with the very brain that's produced the craving. That's not likely to work. It's your mind that is craving, and you're going to try to use your mind to stop it? That's silly. Supported willpower. Not just willpower. Supported will. People go to AA for that very reason. Because willpower by itself won't work. That's how AA got started, because one of the founders realized that he had a lot of willpower and he wanted to stop, but he couldn't do it. And so with treatment, along with trying to erode denial system and get enablers to stop enabling in an environment of abstinence, what a treatment center also hopes to do is to convey some sense of hope. That this is not, you know, you'll stop drinking and be miserable for the rest of your life. This is you'll stop drinking and it'll take some time. But if you go to AA, what you're going to find there, which we can't give you in 30 days, is hope. So we introduce you to this process by which millions of people have gotten sober, stayed sober, and were happy in the process. So I'd you to investigate this stuff because they seem to have found a process that works. So that's pretty much it. Cellular adaptation and tolerance, not a thing you can do. Get the patient to abstain. Cycles of symptoms, not a damn thing you can do. If the drinking continues, get the patient somehow to abstain. Confront the denial, stop the enabling, and find an avenue for hope. And those are the elements that keep this process going, and those are the elements that will help it stop. And it's really not magic. So we talk about this addiction stuff as having phases. We're going to talk about probably three phases, the early stage, the kind of middle stage. After you pass the early stage, you've locked in, okay? And without a catastrophe, you'd likely keep going for a while. Reach the advanced ugly. It's ugly. And it's producing the kind of condition that makes it extremely difficult, increasingly difficult, for the patient to get sober. Sometimes it's because he's so physically dependent on the drug that he can't stop it without real trouble and without clear supervision over a period of time. I mean, you could be in heroin withdrawal for 30 days. Try willpower for 30 days against that. You could be in withdrawal from benzodiazepines for 21 to 28 days, trying willpower to stop that. So here we start. Joe begins drinking. Now, why does Joe begin drinking? He's about 13 years old. What is the myth we've been taught? The reason kids start drinking is because of peer pressure, right? How many have heard that? How many of you still, to some extent, believe it? Whoever made that one up has not talked to kids. Kids, if you tell them what pressure is, of course, if you ask them without definition and say, why do kids drink, they'll say, peer pressure, it's a knee-jerk response. They heard it from their parents, and they've heard it from adults, and so that they believe that adults are telling them the truth. But if you define what pressure is, you say, look, pressure means that a force outside of you is pushing you to take a drink. And if you refuse, they won't let you alone. They'll keep at it. And if you still refuse, they'll call you a pussy. They'll be at you. That's pressure. Now, when you ask kids that question, how many of you have been pressured to drink, the only time you get a yes answer is from a lacrosse player or a pretty girl. Other than lacrosse players and pretty girls, no one's pressured to drink. Why did you start drinking? Why did you take the first one and why did you continue? Now, if you're a lacrosse player or a pretty girl, don't answer that question. Okay? Because lacrosse players, you know what the lacrosse players do. Let's see if we can get sophomore shit-faced. Which, if we translate that, let's see if we can poison the sophomore almost till he's dead. That's stupid. And pretty girls, they all want to see how you act when you're drunk, you know, hoping. Well, never mind. How many of you were ever pressured, given that definition, pressured to drink? Look around. No one has their hand up. Let me give you another option. It's not peer pressure. It's peer acceptance. That's not a force from outside, it's a force within. Peer acceptance means I drank, I took that first one and I drank the others in middle school, let's say, because that's when kids start now, middle school. Used to be high school sophomores, now it's middle school kids. Sixth graders. Okay. How many of you started because of peer acceptance? You wanted to fit in. You wanted to belong. You wanted to be one of the crowd. You wanted to have friends. You didn't want to be left out. You didn't want to be lonely. That's peer acceptance. How many of you got started for that reason? And my guess, how many of you don't want, why the hell you started? Because there are a lot of hands that aren't up. Some of you didn't start, okay? The truth is, when you look at it, it's not peer pressure. It's more like,
you know, like, oh, everybody else is doing this, so I'm going to do it. Friends were doing it.
They just wanted to jump right in and have fun. I did drugs because it seemed like it was fun.
But it was a cool thing to do. The cool thing to do was to get high, go to parties, run up, you know, you're struggling. Couldn't deal with life. So I didn't have to deal with life.
I wouldn't listen to anyone who's stubborn.
Like, it's a rebellious thing.
This is what the rebel kids were doing. They just want to see what it was like.
I started experimenting with it.
Experimenting with friends.
First try, because I was bored.
I was always up to try something new.
Yeah, when I was growing up, we had this program that was just say no, just say no.
People are just saying no, but they're not saying why.
It's like telling a person no, and then they go do it.
Sparked my interest on drugs. I knew that they were bad, and I always heard about this addiction, but I didn't know what it meant.
That's probably the number one reason why I did drugs in the first place. I just didn't know.
Now, you don't know which of them went on to be alcoholics, do you? And the reason is because alcoholics have the same reasons for starting that those people had. There are no unique reasons for addicts to begin drinking, and certainly peer pressure is not a motive for most of us, as a matter of fact. We start because we wanted to fit in, life seemed difficult, we wanted friends, looked like the thing to do. How many of you drank for those reasons? I mean, that's the reason. So this notion that peer pressure is the motive, unfortunately, what it's caused is two things. Is one, it has caused us to create programs of peer resistance education. Just say no. Just say no. Of course, those who are wise about this disease say, and if you can't say no, say treatment. Just say no. Unfortunately, that message is being delivered to a kid who's already said yes. So you're saying just say no to somebody who's already said, hell yes, I'm there, I'm with it, I'm at it. So we not only create programs, the DARE program has been a colossal failure. That is universally recognized. So recognized, as a matter of fact, that DARE has reprogrammed, they've retooled to try a different approach. So they recognize that this business of just say no, of resisting peer pressure, isn't going to work because it's not about peer pressure. All right. One of the things that's gained some foothold is peer education. Schools are trying that. There are a dozen schools in Baltimore that use that approach. And it's, you know, it's not a drugs are evil kind of approach. It's getting kids to help other kids deal with the issues that are going on in their lives. Okay. So the reason for beginning is for addicts, the same as everybody else. There's no unique reason for starting. You can go around this room, and if we got answers about why each of you started, no one in the room would guess that you were alcoholic or not, because they can't. That's not known by the motive for starting. But what does happen to Joe is that he noticed that he drinks more than his peers. He's drinking more. Now, why? Well, two reasons, actually. One, he likes it. People say, why do kids drink? And I said, here's the secret. Are you ready? They like it. It makes them feel good. And in Joe's case, he's drinking more than his peers because he is either already tolerant or starting to be. So he can drink more. That's why he does drink more. And because he likes the feeling. Now, some people like it and then will mature out. Other people will like it and like it and love it and love it until they're pretty successfully hooked into the process. Tolerance increases again. Sometimes it's there from the start. At other times, it just happens. You ask, I have yet to have an alcoholic, other than in joking, because some of them have joked with me about this, tell me that they weren't good at this at the start, and so they tried to develop tolerance. I went on a program of exercise and eat wheat germ and worked out at the gym, and I drank a pint of whiskey and I vomited violently. So I figured, well, it's back to the gym and back to the wheat germ and work harder and put a pint in there again and throw up again. But I kept it up until finally I was tolerant. I have yet to hear anybody tell me that story. I've been around this a long time, okay? Here's what I hear. I was tolerant, or I don't know when the hell it happened. I just woke up one day and realized, boy, I can hold a lot. I can really hold a lot. Okay? Tolerance is not a function of drinking. It's not caused by drinking. It appears to be a separate process. Joe has a blackout. Not a pass out. Blackout means that Joe appears to you and the rest of the world to be conscious. He is walking, talking, and playing ball, or, you know, driving a car or flying an airplane, for Christ's sake. But he has no memory of that the next day. His memory has been blotted out for that experience, which may be mild. Nothing much happened except you just don't remember Jay Leno's jokes. That's all. Or it may be fairly dramatic. You know, you wake up in a foreign place with people that you don't know doing things that you never had intended to do. So they can be one or the other. Not everyone has blackouts. There are plenty of alcoholics who tell you, I've never had a blackout in my life. Others have them early, others have them late, some of them have them scattered out. So it's hard to figure any universal about a blackout, all right? But it's one of the early indications that the brain's response to this drug is interesting. There are apparently some non-alcoholics who have had a blackout. So it's not itself diagnostic. Now, if you've ever had one, it might not mean much of anything. I know someone, in fact, who had a blackout at age 23 and drank her whole life as a social drinker and died without alcoholism. But she had a blackout when she was 23. Joe begins, especially after a period of abstinence, you know, he goes for a week without drinking, he gulps drinks, ingests rapidly, okay, snorts coke line after line, all right, smokes joints heavily, all right. And it's because he's missed the feeling because he's interested in the effect. I want to see how rapidly I can feel intoxication. See, if you gulp a drink, I'm not sure I can justify that as social drinking. I'm a social drinker. Here's to you. Honk. Sweet Jesus, you didn't have time to talk to me, much less interact socially. The goddamn drink went down your throat so fast, I'm sure your taste buds didn't recognize the process. You know, I only drank because I'm thirsty. Oh. If I gave you a half gallon of milk, could you drink it in an evening? No. You've done the same goddamn thing with beer. You drank the equivalent of a gallon of milk. So why won't you do it with milk? Well, I'll be too bloated. Well, then why aren't you so bloated with beer? And the answer is it's not thirst. It's not thirst. There's something in the beer that ain't in the milk. right? And it's that half ounce of alcohol that's in every can. That's what you're after, okay? I drink because I like the taste. Jesus, you like the taste of iced tea, but you don't drink that much of it, is the plain truth. So why are you drinking, gulping and drinking so much? It ain't the taste, and it isn't because you're thirsty. It may be because you're interested in what that percentage of alcohol that's in that beverage, that's what you're after. You look forward to drinking. Joe looks forward to drinking. There are three things to do this weekend. He's going to do all three, but the one he really looks forward to is, in fact, the drinking. He drinks in increasing frequencies and or amounts or both, you know. He drinks more and more often. Why? Because he likes it. Because it makes him feel good. Because he can, he's tolerant. Because you drink and you feel good, he drinks and he feels good. And that's qualitatively different. The most difficult thing for non-alcoholics to understand is the experience of intoxication in an alcoholic. You think it's like you, and it's not. It's qualitatively different. You have a drink or two, and you feel a little bit good and a little bit better, but if you have three and four, you start to feel dizzy or groggy or sleepy or sick or unpleasantly out of control. He has three and four and five and six, and he feels better and better and better and better. And you say, where is the built-in protection against excess? And the answer is, you have it, he doesn't. He doesn't have that built-in protection. You respond to a poison, alcohol, as a poison. He responds to a poison as if it were euphoria on top of itself. Now, he'll experience intoxication at drink 14, but Jesus, an elephant will fall over at that level. He gets subtly worried about how much and how often he drinks. And so he begins to sneak a drink, okay? Use surreptitiously, hide his pot smoking in the garage, snort his Coke on the way home rather than in either place. There are a lot of ways to sneak a drink, and one of the ways is, of course, to fix drinks for everybody else and say, you know, here's your drink, and here's your drink, and here's your drink, and here's your drink, and here's mine. How many drinks you have? One. And guess what? There were seven in that one glass. There were seven drinks in that one glass. Every time you had one drink, you sneak six. Because you mislead people about how much you're actually drinking. You prefer drinking and drugging companions. It's pretty obvious why, right? If all you hang around with are people who drink the way you drink, then your drinking will look normal. I had a patient come in the first day. He said to me, everybody I know drinks the way I do. And I said to him, you probably found them all. And he told me about 10 years later, you were right, you son of a bitch. I had found them all, you know. I only gravitated toward people who drank the way I drank because it helped me feel normal about myself. And there was always supply. You know, if you hang around with alcoholics, nobody forgets to bring the booze. Oh, shit, I'm sorry. I forgot to bring it. Oh, God damn it, so did I. What about that? It doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. There's always supply, and it helps you feel normal. And so it's very convenient. However, there are episodes of acute intoxication. With any other drug, we'd call it overdose. With any other drug, we'd call this overdose. I mean, if you were taking a benzodiazepine and started to stagger and fall down, people might take you to an emergency room, right? But if you do it with alcohol, they'll let you sleep it off. True? Isn't that true? We respond to alcohol intoxication in a very different way than we respond to intoxication for almost any other drug. And you would call them overdoses. You can't focus your eyes. You can't manage speech. You can't walk without staggering. You can't stand up without falling down. You can't have words come out of your mouth. You pass out. You throw up. All of those are very... But don't we accept that as part of the process, you know? How many times last year did you say, you know something, I think I'll drink till I vomit? I would ask a patient that. How many times did you say, I'm going to drink till I vomit? One. How many times did it happen? 114. Then you have 113 instances of unintended intoxication to explain. How many times did you say, I'm going to drink till I pass out? None. How many times did it happen? 12. Then you have 12 instances of unintended acute intoxication. You better try to explain why you get that drunk when you don't mean to. Could be that you're stupid. Could be an accident. Whoops. But after 14, it's not an accident. All right? It could be intentional. I passed out that many times because I wanted to. Then I'd suggest you have a psychiatric issue you may have to look at. But if you say to me those 12 instances were unintended, I didn't mean it to happen, then you better try to give a name to that, because it's happening often enough. Now, we call that loss of control. Unintended acute intoxication, which happens with increasing frequency over a year and longer, is diagnostic. And now you avoid references to your drinking because you're ashamed of it. If you're ashamed of drinking, something's wrong with your drinking. What is it? You're ashamed of it. That's what's wrong with it. If you ask a social drinker, how many drinks did you have last Friday night? Guess what he'll do? He'll tell you. It doesn't upset him. It's not an upsetting topic. If you ask an alcoholic how much you drink last weekend, it'll say, none of your goddamn business. That's touchy. That says there's got to be something wrong with this. Your response to a simple question is kind of alarming. Others become concerned. Nobody's said anything, but they've been rumblings now for some time, and they've been talking to each other. Now it's become a topic of conversation, how often Joe gets shit-faced. At some point, we say this is there's a pattern of loss of control. What will happen next will be critical. What will happen when loss of control becomes a pattern? Take a short break, only 5 minutes, come back in five, and we'll continue with this story.